China's top decision makers are meeting in Beijing this week to discuss the modernization of China's socialist system and governance. What does it mean and why does it matter? And the United Nations World Food Program started its work in China 40 years ago. How has the agency collaborated with China to address hunger and food security? Welcome to The Point, an opinion show coming to you live from Beijing. I'm Bi Xin. The top decision-maker body of the Communist Party of China is holding a closed-door meeting this week to map out the direction for the party and the country in the years ahead. The fourth plenary session of the 19th CPC Central Committee started on Monday and will last 4 days. The agenda is to discuss how to uphold and improve the system of socialism with Chinese characteristics and advance the modernization of China's system and capacity for governance. What does this mean in practical terms? What's significant about this meeting? Joining me for the discussion in the Beijing studio are Zhu Zheng, Assistant Professor of Public Law at the China University of Political Science and Law, and Aina Tangen, Current Affairs Commentator. Gentlemen, welcome to the show. First of all, let's take a look again at the agenda of this plenary session. Members of the Central Committee will discuss some major issues concerning how to uphold and improve the system of socialism with Chinese characteristics and achieve the modernization of China's system and capacity for governance. Let me go to Professor Zhu first. Two things, obviously. One is to uphold and improve the system of socialism with Chinese characteristics, and the other is the modernization of China's system and capacity for governance. In layman's term, what does it mean?
Well, while details of this plenary session are unknown yet, to my best knowledge, these two themes set by the plenary sessions are inseparable, and somehow they are complement one another. Mm-hmm. For the first one, it stressed the importance of the party's leadership, which defines the socialist system in China. Mm-hmm. For the second part, I take it as a means. It means that in future, the committee, the Central Committee, will attach a great importance to the rule of law, and everything happening within the party will be subject to the rule of law. Looking back over the past 5 years, there are lots of law enacted by the Supreme Legislature. And I think a sea of change will be ushered in the upcoming days.
Mm-hmm. Why now? I mean, 70 years of the People's Republic, okay, 40 years of China's reform and opening up, and now we're talking about upholding and improving the system which has been functioning over the past 70 years, and then advancing the modernization of governance. Why this particular juncture?
Well, I think now is a very important point. Looking back at 2014 October, the rule of law was also attached a great importance, and it was a primary theme at that plenary session. Mm-hmm. And over the 5 years, there were lots of changes. So now it's a time to summarize all these changes, and it's time for the Central Committee to usher in even more reforms.
Mm-hmm. Aina, looking from an American and foreign perspective, do you understand what's happening in this meeting and its significance for China?
Well, I can give an interpretation of it. I mean, it's the three M's: message, means, methodology. I agree with my colleague on this. What they're doing is that every year they have to have this as preparation to a further set of meetings. So if you were in the U.S., you would liken this to a corporate meeting of the executive committee. And what they're doing is they're really reverting, looking at the top level from the 30,000 feet above and saying, okay, how do we manage our message? And then what means and methods do we need? And a lot of this is about party building. But this is not suddenly today. This has been on the agenda since Xi came into office. It's part of the anti-corruption drive. It's part of trying to insist that people are more firmly vetted before they're allowed in the party. I mean, in the old days, it was pretty easy. Today, it takes 2 or 3 years, and it's very, very there's a tremendous amount of detailed work involved. Mm-hmm. So he's trying to make sure that the party is able to bring about all the reforms that they've been talking about, you know, anti-poverty, the Belt and Road Initiative, all the kind of long terms. At the same time, China is facing a raft of issues. I mean, you have the U.S. Trade war, you have regional instability in various places between Japan, yeah. South Korea, things like
that. Yeah, well, it's actually quite a unique thing, right, in the world, because you don't hear the Americans talk about improving and upholding their capitalist system, or maybe they do, not to my knowledge, or you don't hear about the U.K. talking about modernizing or bringing it up to date, their system of governance. Why is the Chinese placing so much, why is the Chinese Communist Party or Communist Party of China placing so much importance on improving their system, on reinventing themselves, on strengthening rule of law?
Well, I think first of all, the party's role and the leadership of the party is the defining features in the Chinese society. This was given enshrined in the constitution. I think because of that, the party has to update and reform itself. Over the past few years, there were lots of reform measures being made, and now it's the time to summarize and institutionalize at this crossroads. So I think, for example, the revision of the constitution, the establishment of a supervision law, and also supervisory commissions from the central to local levels, mm-hmm. Lots of measures have already been adopted, mm-hmm. and this is the right moment to institutionalize and putting all these measures together. I think it's the best time.
And I think it's two sides of the same coin. The party is central to the governance of China, but the party must earn the privilege of being that central thing. So it's constantly has to improve itself. Otherwise, it's left behind. In the West, it's always about this kind of, it's a battle between parties. One says yes, the other one says no, and the voters decide.
But the stagnation of the system, right?
Well, it does lead to a stagnation and a lack of planning. China has succeeded because it has planning, because it has this step-by-step process all the way through.
Yeah, and talking about planning, actually China set out a very important roadmap 2 years ago during the 19th Party Congress, where they talked about how China foresee itself in terms of achieving modernization and prosperity. For instance, from 2020 to 2035, China would become a moderately prosperous country, and then by mid-century, China would become a modernized, strong country. And according to that roadmap, a meeting of the Politburo of the CPC Central Committee also mapped out recently a corresponding plan for China's governance. For instance, by 2021, institutions in all fields will have improved notably. By 2035, the modernization will be basically achieved, meaning of the governance system, and by 2049, the modernization will be realized in full. Again, help us understand, Professor Zhu, what this means in exact and concrete terms.
Well, to my knowledge, these are very clear roadmap to achieve modernization. And to achieve modernization, I think the rule of law is a tool, is a means. Only by establishing a law-abiding government will this goal be achieved. So now the party has shown its dedication to pushing ahead with all these measures, to all these reforms, and this should be praised,
yeah.
Home and abroad.
Yeah, people have been...
But let me put it this way, that's the vision. Okay, they're laying out exactly the milestones that they want to achieve.
Right.
But every year, you have to have these plenums, you have to bring in things, because mm-hmm. every year you have to adjust and create the plan, mm-hmm. and then you have to send out the message and make people sure that your means and methods are actually accomplishing your long-term goals.
What does this say, really running out of time, but what does this say of the ability of the party and why China's system has worked over the past four decades at least, that it's able to develop its economy, it's able to keep the society stable and prosperous, and yet this system has been under a lot of criticism from the West. Exactly what about the system that gives this system the vitality and defying all the political theories of the West?
Planning.
It's just
consistent.
And its ability to plan ahead
exactly.
and carry it out step by step.
You hear so much criticism about China being opaque. I always tell people, then you must not be able to read, because if you want to know what China's going to do, it's clearly mapped out. The five-year plans are a comprehensive, from top to bottom and back up to the top, series of documents which say exactly how everything will be done. So China is quite the opposite. It's actually in the West where we don't have any of these goals. We don't talk about it. Donald Trump, nobody. Even before that, no one talks about these
grants. He wouldn't know whether he's in office next year at this
point. Well, it's not even that. There's just no appetite to start talking about what's going to happen in 50 years.
Yeah, Professor Zhu, your answer?
Well, I should say visionary or forward-looking, because the party is the driving force for all these reforms. So the party itself should face these updates and reforms. And only the party itself being updated will this goal be achieved? I should say so.
It's worth pointing out, for instance, in a very latest article in a very important magazine of the party, there was this speech that President Xi gave at the beginning of last year, seeking where he is entitled Improvement of the Great New Project of Party Building Must Be Consistent, where he talked about the party must have the courage to self revolution, to reinvent itself, to make party building even stronger. What's the relevance of this speech at this released at this moment to this very important meeting, Professor Zhu?
As I just said, the party is a driving force of the whole society. So how to re-energize itself is very important. So according to my knowledge, the president attached importance to the party governance, to the party revolution, is very important because it's the driving force.
And keep in mind, this was last year in Choshur, which is the publication that's put out by the standing committee. So it's really what China has to do in order to have a one-party system. It must constantly improve. It cannot just sit back and wait for the opposition to say that they're wrong. Yeah. It has to be internal.
Yeah, there's no escape. There is no blaming on any opposition party. It is all
that's a strength and a weakness.
Yeah,
and it's a real burden.
Weakness.
It's a
if
huge
you're
burden.
Able to
it's a huge burden.
Yeah, if you're able to constantly deliver, then you will always keep your legitimacy. All right, we have to leave it there. Thank you so much, Professor Zhu Zheng from China University of Political Science and Law, and Aina Tangen, current affairs commentator. And you have been watching The Point with me, Liu Xin. We'll take a short break and we'll be back right after this. Stay with us.